Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and today I thought I'd do some inking. I want to show you guys what I've been up to recently, and I have my drafting board all set up so that I've got the camera looking at me this way so we can have a proper conversation while it's doing a screen capture. Before I had like this overhead camera, see if I can have one of these things, right? And it was like shining, looking down on the screen, and it kind of works. It worked okay-ish, but I found that the lighting was funny. Like I the backs of my hand, or you know, everything would be super super dark, and the screen would be super super bright, and it would just look weird. And anyway, it does work, and it has some really neat advantages. You could actually see what the pen is actually doing. Whereas here, you're going to see just the cursor moving around, but you see me talking. I thought, oh, well, we'll try it out. Anyway, I had just some sketches here that I was doing some warm-up inks on. just drew a lightsaber. Jenny as a Jedi. I don't think I quite got her face here, though. This doesn't quite have that Jedi look. Let's try and do a proper Jedi look here. Let's erase that. See if we can't come up with something a little bit more, I don't know, more Star Warsy. So we got her in this with the cloaks, right? And I don't know. We have a bunch of faces here. Like, oh, this is probably my favorite sketch. She was taping up her feet with some, I guess, like athletic tape or something like that. I just love capturing these sort of weird, you know, like humans often take on these positions because we're super flexible and we can take on all kinds of shapes, and people just normally draw standing or sitting, but I like these sort of weird poses that just take a lot of thinking. Like, how do you draw that correctly? And when they come out correctly and you can sort of capture the real feel of it, yeah, that's actually what a human looks like when they're sitting like that. I feel really chuffed. It's like, It's a good feeling, right? This is sort of I'm always experimenting with different sort of Jenny styles. I was going a little bit more wider hips, thinner waist. Head's a little big on that one. Just trying different things out. You know, that one came out all right. And then I had one over here, which isn't even Jenny. It's just like I was just going for this kind of interesting face. Like I saw a girl and she kind of had this like 80s, it was just a photograph. I was doing some photo reference and she had that sort of 80s puffy hair. So I was doing that, but she kind of had this sort of like, I don't know, is that a snarky expression? It's hard to tell. Anyway, that was kind of a, it came out all right. And then this one killed me, man. I was trying to draw this and this friggin' nose, man. Hey, let's get that out. This is what I started with. It's the pencil. Let's ink that again, just to sort of see if I can show you what I was talking about. Yeah, that took a lot of work. It looked okay in the pencils, but just killed me when I was trying to ink it correctly. Let's give it a nice thick brush. Now, one of the things I found with this setup, because I'm still sort of experimenting with how to make. Let's go zoom in so you can really see that. How to make videos is, I thought I was like totally set up, you know, had the best hardware, meaning I got something really cheap that would do the job, because Photoshop and Clip Studio Paint don't actually require a whole lot of CPU crunch, you know, not that this raster stuff is, you know, technology from 10 years ago pretty much defeated all the challenges that you could sort of throw at it in terms of, you know, hardware ability. But man, when you team it up, like the same computer is also now doing stream capture, video capture, as well as tracking where my pen is and all this other stuff and doing audio. So the computer is doing a lot of tasks and most of it isn't this, but the result is that the line gets a bit choppy. I can't draw and ink as quickly as I'd like. So when I make these videos, I don't know, I find I have to sort of slow down a bit, and it kind of gets in the way of my style, man. But let's see here. But I like to do a bit of inking and drawing before I sort of get down to work correctly or proper, just to sort of warm up and get into it. That's what I tell everybody. That's what I tell students, that if I ever have them, say, yeah, do warm-ups. You'll thank yourself. Your artwork always looks so much better. But often I just don't. I just dive right in, and then, you know, the first hour of my work is just kind of crunchy and not good, and I often regret it. So I'm really making a concerted effort here to, like, all right, I'm going to do sketches. Like I tell it, you know that thing is like, do as I tell you, not as I do, or screw that. I want to actually take my own advice. So that's kind of the way. It's springtime. It's time to, you know, set up new practices. I don't believe, like, the New Year's resolution thing really doesn't work. Partly because everyone in the wintertime, they're going to, it's hibernation time, right? So people want to, they're not in the right headspace. They don't have the energy to really embody new changes. But springtime, man, it's like you've got all the spare energy. And that's the perfect time, I figure, to enact promises to yourself. How does she look? See, this is what I'm saying. Like, when I ink the lines accurately, or what's actually there, I find it just kind of comes out a bit odd. I mean, that's kind of neat, but let's see what I had before. So let's get rid of that and put the new one up. And that's what I fought it into. Anyway, it was an interesting facial expression. I don't normally work. I've been trying to really practice faces in a way that's not cartoony, because this is my regular style. Like, I'm a strip cartoonist at heart, you know, who just does comic books and expands what I do with backgrounds and whatnot. But this sort of stuff here is where I'm most comfortable, and I can make a lot of expression happen with just a few little lines. I do love it. Hey, this spring I want to push onward, right? I want to learn new skills. Oh, see, isn't that great? Look, there's like one little line here, and let's zoom in here. There she is. Just a quick little line, a few little dots, and she's just got this, you can tell she's sort of, what is she thinking? She's a little puzzled. She's a little, you know, what is she looking at? It just, there's so much expression that can be brought to a picture. And then over here, you know, that's not bad. I'm not unhappy with that. This one I was trying to get, it's a little, this one looks like Instagram art, right? It's just, it's pretty, you know, I don't know, man. It's bland and not there. It's very pretty. No, I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in, like, these kind of shots here, right? Where she's like, what's happening? Anyways. Okay. Yeah. We have a headless Jedi here. Let's do something about that. All right. Now, I don't know how good it's going to be for sketching, because I do have this this video capture stuff, like, slowing down, you know, gumming up the works, man. But we'll see what it looks like. So she's got to be, see, I figure a Jedi has to be sort of more thoughtful. They're very stoic, you know, creatures. And what does Jenny look like? Jenny can do stoicism, but I'm not sure she's actually cut out for the Jedi order. She's a little bit too, there's too much charisma in that girl. She just sort of gets fed up, right? So let's some hair hanging down in front of her face. It's been sort of and then there's some sweat back here. She's maybe just stepped out of the desert, and, you know, Jedi don't spend a lot of time on hair preparation, which is fine, because Jenny's hair is often just sort of a scrub brush of red straw, you know. And she's going to be arching her eye at you. Oh, that's cute. I don't know if it's Jedi. I don't know if I'd feel like. And it's the wrong side. I find that's the thing with these tablets, right? See, I'm zooming on. Okay, there's the great face, and the scale's all wrong, man. That's like a basketball head. Let's do some. I'm gonna expand the body, not shrink the head, because I like that head. It looks really cute. And smooth edges. that's the nice thing. You know, the digital medium allows you to screw up scale really easy, but it also allows you to fix it really easy. So I guess it's a forgivable flaw. It's a weird quirk of the medium. She looks all right, I guess. I don't know about that mouth. But anyways, all right. Enough mucking around. That's how long have we been at this? Does this thing tell me how many? 10 minutes of recording time. Whoa. All right. What I really wanted to get to was the good stuff. Let's see here. Let's go over to enough practice. So I've been working on these pages where I'm like drawing Toronto. And I wanted to show you a little bit of that process, right? Now these are crazy big pages. I went for extremely high resolution, and then I needed to drop in some, you know, some perspective work. See, if you need to figure out lines of perspective, and if you're just working on, you know, just the square of the actual comic page itself, sometimes you're vanishing. I'll draw them right on top. Let's get another layer here, demo layer. So. Wow, there's so many layers on this. I don't even know what to turn off here. You're not going to worry about it. But let's go in on here. I'll show you what I'm talking about. So say this is your page, right? So there's your comic page. And if you have to draw, like, you know, a house in perspective, see, this is that, you know, it would look like this. Now, to do that accurately, you'd have to set up your horizon line, and you get your vanishing points. And you have to like draw all your lines off, but you see how the vanishing points are actually off the artboard. So where do they go? You know, are you drawing them right off onto your drafting board? Like if this is your drafting board and you're sitting, your pencils are here, and here's your eraser, and you got like your desk lamp, you know, it's sticking out like this. I'm actually going to draw it. So, I'm getting a little technical on this. This is fun. And you taped up your page here. There's your lamp. All right. So, this is what you're drawing, right? But where do you put these stupid points? You can, you know, maybe put push pins right into the drafting board itself, but with a digital drafting board, you don't have that option. You know, if you move this thing around, everything else moves. So I said, you know what? I'm gonna make the canvas big enough to contain the vanishing points that I need. But it becomes an enormous document because this is super high res. Like, look how far I can zoom in on this stuff. Like, I can zoom in, and before we're seeing pixels, it's like, you know, we're looking at like a centimeter. So here we are. There's Tammy's eye, you know, and you can see where the pixels start to show up. But this is such a, like, you can zoom out forever on this thing, right? It's such a giant image. So it's very, very taxing on my old computer. So I am thinking of maybe getting a bigger, stronger, smarter, faster, better computer. Can't skip that. So anyway, what I wanted to do was, I've been finding myself super slowed down by these Toronto pages, just because normally you just dive in, you draw whatever you want. I'm really good at drawing sort of backgrounds just out of my imagination. But when it actually has to look like something, holy smokes. So as you can see on the page here, I've got all these photo references. Let's, there we go. Man, I gotta get a new computer. It's totally stuttering as I try and pan around. So there's in Toronto on Yonge Street. This back in the 80s, it's gone now. I don't think Sam is still selling records, not in this day and age where everything's downloadable. But back in the 70s and 80s, he was a big name. He had like this big hunk of very famous real estate on Toronto's Yonge Street. And Yonge Street in Toronto is kind of like, it's sort of like Times Square for New York. You know, it's that's where all the focus, all the life of the whole city. Not necessarily focuses, but that's the main artery of life energy that moves in that city. And Sam had, you know, he was just like an independent record sales guy, right? And so I think I have some pictures from previous. Let's see here. Don't think you, I have lot. I've spent so much time looking for photo references for all of this. I don't have anyway, whatever. But over the years, the record store, would sort of like change the way it looked. So like, in the 80s, there was just one front, and in the 90s, it moved over and took over this space as well, or this space and this space, and they put up extra signage. He just sort of expanded because he was just becoming more and more successful selling records and CDs and whatnot. But his big claim to fame is this crazy. Circular neon sign, right? He see Toronto has this neat character. There are these three character, these businessmen from the 60s with these, they're all like furniture salesman types. Like, I think every major city has one of these guys. I think it comes standard. They issue them with every city. There's the furniture king. He'll have like a warehouse. He'll buy cheap furniture from the suppliers, bring them all to a warehouse, and run TV spots on the local, network. The cable network, and they'll do corny stuff. They'll have I think even the Coen brothers in one of their films, like Raising Arizona, like the major, the big businessman. He was one of these dudes. He was just this loud guy. Did these big furniture ads. Everyone's seen them anyway in Toronto. There's a guy named Mel Lastman. He did that. Mel Lastman, he became the mayor. So this sort of always intertwined with politics and whatnot. But he would do these ridiculous ads where he'd dress up like in like the stripe, the black and white stripe, jailbird, escapee outfit. And it was all about the lowest prices. We're breaking all the laws to give, that kind of nonsense. Anyway, Sam, he was one of these guys too. There was a guy named Ed Mervish. And there was another fellow who ran this big jean store. And he sold clothing and one, and they're like carnival barkers, and they defined a major portion of the character of Toronto through the 70s and 80s. It was, it just made the city kind of corny and fun. It felt like going down to an exhibition or a carnival or and so Sam's was like this, and he'd always have these nutty deals, and he was into like big ostentatious displays, and so this was a real iconic piece. So I wanted to have Tammy, as she's running down Yonge Street to get to her next date on the on her little adventure to run by Sam's. I just wanted to capture it. So I thought about it. How am I going to do it? And what does it even look like? And I spent a lot of time studying just sort of how the neon bars in this thing work. And then right in the middle, there's this thing that says, "That's entertainment." And I wanted to sort of have that be part of the focus of the page. Because sometimes the signage, you're going to notice it as a reader. It's going to register subconsciously, and I wanted that to sort of inform part of the narrative on sort of a texture layer, an emotional texture, because she's in the middle of like trying to defuse a bomb. She's out there racing for her life, and meanwhile, all the signage is sort of on a different level, looking down and winking, and they're sort of enjoying the spectacle of all the people walking up and down the street. Anyway. This one's almost done. I think this took a long time to do, just because all these details are driving me bananas. Like, because it's not just, you can't just look at it today. This is from 1985. There's a specific date that I wanted this to happen, and you're going, well, I could fudge it, but someone's gonna know, someone's gonna check, and even if they don't, I'm gonna know, and it's gonna drive me nuts. So I spent all this time, and these are just the photographs that lent themselves to this particular scene. This was a really good find. This was like a looking down at Yonge and Dundas from the Eaton Centre above. And so this is a really good, because a lot of these shots you'll sort of see, one angle, and then you don't know what the date is, and then you'll see this one, and you go, is this even from the same decade? And how does, because buildings change, people will tear things down and put up new frontices. You're not sure what things look like, and so it just takes, you're doing all this detective work to try and figure out what the heck things are. Oh, let me show you one of my favorites. So we'll go over to the next page, and there was this arcade that was really popular. It was this thing right here. this huge front sign. It was just this ugly, kind of dingy arcade, and everyone knew about it. It had all the cool new, you know, pinball machines and video games. It had been around for a long, long time. It's long gone now. You'd walk in and you'd sort of smell a waft of marijuana smoke, you know, from the 80s. You sort of felt like you were risking your life if you're like 10 or 12 years old and you're going downtown. You want to go, you got like a couple of quarters in your pocket and you want to go play Dig Dug or whatever. Going in there, you're like, oh, I don't know if it's safe, man. I may never come out, but the draw of the video game is enough to pull you in anyway. This was like, it's one of my, I don't know, has like a lot of mythic sort of significance in my memory. So I want to have her running past that, and I came up with a bunch of different poses to sort of show her sort of stopping and looking around. But I wanted to show you this really neat discovery. I've become like an investigative reporter almost, in a way that I never thought I ever would. Like, doing all this photo reference was just so challenging. But I came across a piece of video. I didn't think, I was looking on sort of Google Images and going through books that I'd found like from that particular age. I scanned a lot of pages out of books. And I also made the decision that I didn't want to do a lot of sketch work. I wanted to sort of reconstruct things. So look, you know, learn what the shapes of buildings were and then draw my own, because it would just feel much more authentic as a reader. And I wanted to be a completist. It's just a lot of work. And as you can tell, like the page production time has just been really, it's just really dropped. When I'm done with this whole corner and the Eaton Center, which is the next sort of scene, man, I'm just going to dive right back into like just bullshit pages, you know, the kinds where it's just all from my mind. But I think that's going to be even improved, because I'm learning so much about architectural detail and just sort of the way things fit together. It's going to really, this kind of challenge is aggravating. Like, I'm enjoying learning about it, but it's making me nuts because I just want the stupid thing done. Anyway, I didn't even think for a long time to check out things like YouTube. And then I found some video clips of certain scenes, and this was a really neat one. So there was someone who had a video camera, and this scene was sort of shot, I think it was in the 90s, and they just stood here on the corner of Yonge and Dundas and panned the camera, did like a big, maybe 300 degree turn, right? And so all I did was I just took screen caps at each point and pasted them together. So I had this nice little, really, really useful stretch of data, of information. And it could answer questions like, oh, I knew there was a Mr. Submarine, you know, down on that corner in the 80s, but, you know, what do the logo look like? And, well, it's all here. I don't have to piece everything together. So this was a really major discovery. I was very, very happy to find this. So that's what I've been up to. And let me just, drawing arcade machines from the 80s is that's exciting too. Just there's so many neat little details that I want to get to. And Tammy's such a nice, she's such a lovely character. She's so, you know, she's the sort of character when you say there's trouble, there's danger, she's quite serious. She's like, oh my God, she's invested, right? So now she's running and panting. She's got to save the day, but she doesn't even know how, and she's not really set up for this. So she's a great character to sort of drop into an adventure like this. Anyway, this video is now 23 minutes. I've been talking and gabbing a whole lot. So I'm going to wrap it up here, get back to, I was going to do some inking for you on this, but we've gone too long. I've been talking too much. So I want to thank you for tuning in, and I'll catch you again when I do. And if you like this content, hit like and subscribe, do all that stuff. Leave any comments in the section below. Love to chat with you. I'm building this channel super slowly, right? But I don't think I'm going to go anywhere. I'm really enjoying this whole making videos process. When I get to chatting, it's really neat. I just have to sort of get into the rhythm of it and do it on a regular basis. Thanks for watching, and I hope you have a great day. Take care.